Hello students, good morning and welcome to the video lecture series on vernacular architecture. Today I would like to discuss building materials and construction techniques in vernacular architecture as part of module 4. So we'll start the discussion now. For thousands of years, wood and stone have determined the character of buildings. According to Amos Rapoport, the evolution of vernacular architecture is attributed to various materials and techniques available at the time of their construction. As a rule, the materials used in vernacular construction were exposed in their natural state, but for reasons of weather protection or fashion, they were often concealed. The stability of vernacular structures largely depended on the construction technology involved and not on the strength of individual materials used. The stability was mainly achieved by perfecting the geometry in accordance with the gravitational forces, and the same stability is visible to all. More than any other single component, walling material decides the character of a structure of vernacular architecture. Besides, there are cases where the roof is dominant and the roof decided the character. For example, vernacular buildings in Kerala. When we talk about the wall construction in vernacular architecture, two structural systems are significant. One is mass construction and the other is frame construction. In the former, the loads of the roof and the floor are carried to the foundation by means of walls. These walls also provide the weather protective envelope to the spaces within the building. In the latter, the loads of the roof and the floor are carried by a frame which transferred these loads to the foundation. In this case, the weather protective envelope is non-load bearing and can be independent of the frame. Materials used for mass construction include stone, flint, cobble, brick, and earth. Some other materials were laterite and snow. Of these, only earth and snow provided a homogeneous mass. All others are some small pieces joined together. So, for each material, for stability and weather protection, one has to rely on the skill with which individual pieces are put together, the stability of the joining material, and the quality of the basic material. This is a stone house. Stone could be of irregular type or regular type. This one is made of irregular type of stones. Irregular stone walls may be of compact type, elongated type, slate type, or quarry faced blocks. Sometimes no bonding material is used and the joints are dry joints, and sometimes either mud or lime is used. To stabilize the corners, bigger and better finished stones are used as quoins. For regular type stone construction, the courses can be of uniform height or of varying heights. Length of individual stones also may be uniform sometimes, or may have varying lengths. The corners are closed with dressed stone to suit the architectural fashion. The gaps between the courses are kept as thin as possible and often pointed with lime. Regular stone masonry is seldom plastered. Then flint. Flint masonry are of two types. Those which resembles flat-topped teeth having its root penetrated into the wall, or those with exposed ends which is square and smooth surfaced, known as nabbed flint work. The joints of round flint work are usually wide compared to nabbed flint work. Brick quoins, jambs, and horizontal lacing courses at intervals are the ways adopted for stabilizing flint masonry. Now it is about cobbles and pebbles. Cobbles are stones with diameter 3 inches to 9 inches, and pebbles are with diameter less than 3 inches. For walling, either the stones with flattened face or egg-shaped ones are used. Cobbles being mostly uneven, laid uncaused in clay bedding, whereas pebbles being more uniform, laid in courses. The masonry is reinforced with intermediate stone lacing courses. The corners are strengthened with brick coins and jambs. Now we will discuss the brick walling. In early days, the brickwork was inferior and hence the bond was not recognizable. For later stage brickworks, people used English bond or Flemish bond or the header stretcher bonds. The joints were thick for irregular brickwork and were thin for fine brickwork and were often pointed with lime. As I told earlier, mud provided a homogeneous mass walling. Walls were thick, irregular, and required protection unless used for purely temporary shelters. Mud is often reinforced with straw bales for better strength. People employed several techniques for mud walling. Either they used dam mud directly or made bricks, sun-dried it, and then constructed the wall. Circular plans were found appropriate for mud structures. Most of the earlier constructions of the west coast of India, they used laterite. Laterite is nothing but earth solidified over time due to action of carbonates in the atmosphere, and the process is known as induration. Laterite is technically known as plinthite, which is soft laterite, and petroplinthite, which is hard crust laterite. Finely cut blocks are used for walling. Very thin joints in laterite masonry exhibits the skill of the craftsman. Since laterite is soft, it can also be sculptured. The construction using snow is attributed to the Eskimos of the polar region, and such structures were known as igloo. Here in igloos, there is no distinction between the wall and the roof, as the wall itself is curved and becomes the roof. The stability of the structure is due to the freezing of the layers of ice into a monolithic block. Stability of the wall made of separate pieces of material was a major challenge, which probably governed the technique of construction. Stability of the foundation was not a major issue, as the height of the buildings were less. In case of soft soils, either the soil was stabilized or used large boulder stones for foundation. Collapse of the wall due to outward buckling was addressed in the following manner. Heavy floor beams were given to tie the opposite walls. The outward pressure at the top due to triangulated roof was countered by heavy tie beams. Long narrow plans were divided into self-buttressing cells using cross walls. Horizontal timber members were bounded into the casing of the walls. Brick walls were either bellied out or tied back with the aid of iron plates and rods. Small stones like cobbles and pebbles were bedded in deep clay, held together with the help of intermediate lacing course, and the stone coins and jambs were used at the corners for more stability. Number, size, and proportion of the openings were limited, as the strength was getting reduced due to this. For earthen walls, circular or fluid geometric shapes were adopted. Plans were divided into small cubic compartments. Wall cross sections were made wide enough, maintained low heights for spaces and rooms. Openings were made as narrow as possible. With that, we'll finish discussion on part 1. Thank you.